We've had one or two comments and people asking the questions about how easy or how difficult it must be to de-anonymize data. So it's a problem, isn't it?
Absolutely. I mean, so I think a few years ago, 2013, there was a published study where they took 1.5 million phone records for in a small European country, probably Belgium from one of the authors, and they randomly selected four locations. They were sort of the nearest cell tower, and from that they could uniquely re-identify 95% of the database. And by choosing 11 data points, they got 100%. They were able to uniquely identify who these people were. And underlying that is, you know, some simple observations about people tend to live somewhere, work somewhere, and even those two data points are probably enough to uniquely identify folks. And then you can look for everything else tagged with that, and you can probably track people around. So it's actually lots of examples of where what seems like a large amount of random data is not, because it actually it contained within it its huge amounts of structure. It's always difficult to imagine how one can anonymize a data set, and it's create a data set that has records which are associated with an individual, where we essentially just, you know, delete the name or replace it with some code, a random number. It's very difficult to defend that against all possible future attacks, because someone could turn up with another data set which includes, I don't know, three or four of the fields that are the same as the anonymous data set, but with a name associated with it. And then by correlating those two data sets together, you'll get a set. It may not be a one-off, but you might get a set of candidates of, I think the following four anonymous records could be this person because they match on some of the fields. And then you could start saying, well, let's look at then in the anonymous record what the other fields are. And maybe there's something entertaining or scurrilous about that, or privacy invasive that people wouldn't want to know. And this is very much the attack we saw on the film rating database, where people rated films with their names on them. And then an anonymized data set was published with so-and-so rented all these, you know, this anonymous person rented all these films. Give us a better recommendation algorithm for them. So there's a big record of all these anonymous identifiers. But of course, you watch a film and you write a review. So even though this set of people who had published their reviews had not reviewed every film they watched, the fact that you could correlate, they obviously rented these movies and then made their reviews probably shortly afterwards, caused you to be able to take that publicly identifier and associate it with all the movies they'd watched, including the ones perhaps they didn't want people to know about. So the classic is politicians getting, you know, caught watching adult content, and that's very embarrassing for them. And the thing is that if someone says, here's anonymous data, where the records still contain all the data, and it's associated with an individual, or maybe we call that pseudonymized, it's very difficult to protect against all possible future databases that might arise with real names associated with them. And that's the problem with the de-anonymization is a threat that's always there. So that's a fundamental problem if what you have is a record per person, no matter what you do. I think there's another thing as well which I'd perhaps mention in that space. Sometimes the way in which people choose the anonymous identifier is pretty dire, really. So New York cab company decided to publish all the pickup and drop-off points of all the yellow cabs, and they anonymized the badge number of the driver. Now, in fact, there aren't that many badges. So someone computed all the possible hash values of the badges, and hence you're able to just invert the whole thing. And so you're able to re-identify because there was an algorithmic means to produce the anonymous identifier. In fact, what you really want to do is just, even if you do want to do this, you really just need to generate a random number. Do not make it a hash value when the space of values is not that large. Brute force attacks. It's a bit like cryptography. It was really hard. It took a lot of work to break Enigma during the Second World War, right? But these days, your average PC would crack it in seconds, if that. So the slowly increasing, you know, processing power that's available, and the fact that we have GPU cards with hundreds of GPUs on them, or even more so cryptographic accelerators, as we see in some of the some of the modern processors. If you have all of that, those engines there, then the challenge is that you simply have to keep making the problem harder and harder. So the next thing you could try to do is say, well, why don't we do the sorts of techniques that the census adopt, which is they don't publish per postcode data, because even that's too fine grain. They aggregate the data up such that the statistics that they publish are at the levels of, you know, hundreds or thousands of people. And that doesn't completely prevent re-identification, but it certainly starts to make it substantially harder. And some of the times, like cryptography, the mission is to make it substantially harder and to put it beyond reasonable computational resources. After all cryptography falls into that category. It's not like you cannot break cryptography. You just do brute force. Just may take 1,000 years. But remember, what was predicted to take 1,000 years in 1945 is now, you know, milliseconds on a modern computer. So you always got to factor in that. So that the issue is how difficult you make this for people to re-identify. And of course, essentially, you know, when you get down to it, this is what intelligence agents have been doing for years. I mean, they've been looking at all sorts of random sources of information and understanding how they all correlate together. So even when you are aggregated, it may still be possible to re-identify within that group. And it has to be not just that you aggregate to within, say, 100 people or something. It also has to be that there can be no population of, I don't know, less than 10 or 20 in that group. I mean, my son was asked to fill in a survey at school, and they said, oh, it's all completely anonymous. And they asked for his postcode. Now, he sat at dinner long enough listening to me go on about this repeatedly. And he then put in a bogus postcode. And he said, well, it's ridiculous because there's only two of us kids at school of a school age on this street. And I said, no, it's worse than that, son. He lives around the corner. That's a different postcode because it's a different street name. He said, there's precisely one, you know, 15-year-old child on this street. So it was uniquely identifying. And something that someone thought, well, that'll be fine. You know, it wasn't, because actually, although there are a number of people live in our street, there's only one. There was only one 15-year-old at the time, so it was uniquely identifying. So it's a complex problem, even when you aggregate to try to anonymize, because you've got to think about, you know, is it a unique sample within that aggregate, in which case it's still a problem. So you find that the people who've been doing this for years, which is people like the Office of National Statistics, they have tried and tested mechanisms where they've evaluated the risk of re-identification. And that's how they publish things like census data and the data that they publish every month that comes out of the ONS. They're very careful about that. Now, this is something that actually has become recently, I've noticed, become very interesting to lots of companies who are trying to deal with data protection, the new general data protection regulation coming in the EU. Where they're saying, well, what on earth can we possibly do? Because we're allowed to keep these pseudonymous records, but what does that mean? And I heard a very sensible colleague from a large company say, well, why don't we do what the ONS does? Because they've had a 100 years experience of this, and they seem to know what they're doing, and surely we can carry the same level of risk as they can. So it is a very subtle problem, but like most of these things, in the same way that I would simply say that there is no cryptography that is completely bulletproof. It's a question of just how difficult is it to crack the crypto. When it comes to anonymization, the question is how difficult is it to break the anonymization? And you're simply applying new, interesting, and different perspectives and different data assets to the original one. You know, things that the original creator never thought about will be the attacks. So our mission always has to be simply to make it at least provably challenging computationally to do, and that's personally, maybe some genius is going to come up some way that really does work, but I have yet to see anyone who would believe that we truly can anonymize in the same way that other than one-time pads in cryptography, we can't do crypto that's not open to brute force attack. Doesn't really matter, but they started discriminating against that, and BitTorrent was the classic, where lots of people were discriminating against BitTorrent. But then, of course, it turns out that many people were using BitTorrent for perfectly legitimate reasons. Yes, there were BitTorrent file sharing, and there still is plenty of it around.